In the second part, we will start with another style of leadership, which is called bureaucratic or rule-centered leadership. The leader's behavior is characterized by a high degree of reliance on rules, regulations, and procedures to which both he and his subordinates subscribe. As a result, the process of administration is reduced to a series of routine actions. The rules specify the obligations of the subordinates and enjoin upon them to do particular things in specified ways. There is no participation or initiative on their part. This style of leadership fosters worker apathy. The rules serve as a specification of the minimum level of acceptable performance. It is possible for workers to remain apathetic, for they know just how little they should do to remain secure in their jobs. This leads to what is called a bureaucratic sabotage, a deliberate apathy fused with resentment, so that every act of conforming to the letter of the rule is accompanied by a conscious intention to violate it. Rules make it possible for workers to indulge in activity without participation. They enable them to work without being emotionally committed to work. Rules also lead to red tapeism and the habit of passing the buck, much paperwork, and too great desire to play safe. Next is manipulative leadership. This style of leadership is based on the belief that employees are persons who should be manipulated by the leaders so that his goal may be attained. It exploits the aspirations of the employees. Under this style of leadership, employees know that they are being manipulated and therefore become resentful and bitter. A manipulative leader, however, is very sensitive about the needs and desires of his employees and the individuals. But the information gathered as a result of his sensitivity is not used for the benefit of the employees. Instead, it is utilized by him for his own personal profit. The main characteristic of this style of leadership, personal goals are reached by manipulation of the employees. B. Employees' need and desires are viewed as tools to extract performance. The style of leadership is effective only in specific situations, for example, when cooperation and coordination have to be achieved on a project and a previous leader were unable to motivate the group. Next comes expert leadership. This is an emerging style of leadership resulting in part from the complexity of modern organizations. The basis for expert leadership is the individual leader's knowledge and ability. And he assumes the role of a leader regardless of his age, sex, physical or other attributes. It depends largely on the appropriate mix of his skills and the need of others in a given situation. With any change in a particular situation, another person may become the leader who would meet the needs arising out of the change. In these circumstances, a person is looked upon by group members as an expert who must continuously demonstrate his expertise in order to maintain his position as a leader. Then we come to degrees of leadership. In every organization, a different style of leadership will be demonstrated, from the strong autocratic to the liberal free rein. The successful leader or manager knows how to shift techniques effectively depending on the interaction of many forces on the types of people involved, that is the maturity and dedication of the followers, the changing conditions and the problems, and the traits and abilities of the supervisors as an individual. It is important to realize that the leadership styles used by an individual must constantly change to meet the new situations and the need of the new people. If he is flexible, he would be less likely to be considered the problem of the leadership as some kind of a dilemma. According to Golmswick, the modern view is that the group-centered style is most conducive to the productivity. The traditional view considers the group-centered style as a plaything of the psychologists and dismisses a free rein style as constituting the leadership, but rather its surrender. Now, the task management or autocratic leadership style, the lower right hand corner of the quadrant represents the style. Here, a great concern for production is coupled with a low concern for people. That is, the manager has the minimum concern for people. The job concept is to meet schedules, get production out, and tell the people what to do. Then, country club or democratic leadership style. Attitudes, feelings, and needs of the employees are more important than production. Therefore, he not only issues orders but interprets them and sees to it that the employees have the necessary skills and tools to carry out their assignments. He assigns a fair workload to his personnel and recognizes the job that is well done. There is a team approach to the attainment of organization goals in this style. The subordinates are supervised, guided, and aided rather than threatened and commanded to work. In return, the manager expects loyalty and devotion rather than accountability from his subordinates. The assumption is that disciplinary action breeds discontent and frustration among the employees and creates an unhealthy work environment. There is room for information, communication in this managerial style. It provides an outlet for the social and emotional aspect of the acceptance of decision by subordinates. It's very important. The democratic attitude of the manager enables him to maintain a high level of morale, and the involvement of his employees in the decision-making process gives them a sense of belonging. A selection is made on the basis of the qualifications, experience, personal characteristics, and sociability of the subordinate rather than on the whims and fancies of the manager. Training is directed towards broadening the attitudes and outlook of the employees. Now, the laissez-faire leadership style. This approach to organizational objectives results in a low degree of commitment to organizational goals. In a minimum effort and contribution and in low morale, the manager acts more or less like a messenger. He is not fully aware of the various programs to be undertaken to achieve the organization goals. In the circumstances, whenever subordinate come up with difficulties or any problems, he often will say, I shall talk to my boss and then let you know what to do now. And the communication system in this style management very much resembles that of a government department. That is, the message are delivered, nothing else is done. This style of management is followed by those who are constantly bypassed at the time of promotions or who function mostly in the unchallenging work situations. They try not to rock the boat and accomplish just enough to avoid pressure from their superiors. Middle of the road or practical leadership style, this is the center of the quadrant, here you have seen, represents the 5.5 managerial style. In this style, management equal weight is given to concern for people and concern for production. Under this management style, employees are not driven, pushed or forced, but are requested and motivated to do a job. Communication in this style of management is well developed. There is a suitable climate for a two-way communication system. The relationship between the superior and the subordinate is one of the give and take. Group meetings are frequently held and suggestions are often invited from the employees. This system of communication avoids organizational conflict. And this style of management, however, does not offer much scope for creativity. Now we come to team management. Here, a high concern for people is coupled with a high concern for production. This system aims at discovering a scientific and effective solution of organizational problems. Accomplishment and contribution are considered to be the barometers of organizational performance. The manager's prime responsibility is to see to it that each and every activity leads to the attainment of organization goals. For this purpose, the manager delegates authority to subordinates and makes them accountable for the work allotted to them. This typical manager says, my job is not only to take sound decisions, but also to ensure that they are effectively carried out. Under this style, the assumption is that people have a clear understanding of organizational goals. A strict control of their activity would not be necessary. Mistakes provide an opportunity for learning. Employees are committed to attain the targets of production because individuals and organization goals are complementary. Communication in this style of management aims at promoting an understanding of problems and a sharing of information, thoughts and ideas. Though the emphasis is on the unity of effort, a certain amount of conflict is bound to develop in the process of action, which relates to the policies and methods of work and which sometimes results in the emergence of new ideas. There is realistic assessment of an individual's capabilities, limitations, strengths and weaknesses. Management development begins at the highest level and then moves down to the lower level. The condition which promotes this kind of management style is the upward shift in the educational status of the employees. Persons with great skills and mature judgment are not expected to function in an atmosphere of strict authority and obedience, or on unchallenging jobs, or in organizations in which there is no scope for future advancement. Rensselaer-Likert, four systems of management. The system was developed by Rensselaer-Likert at the University of Michigan. His concept grew out of the study of numerous organizations over a number of years. It is characterized by three types of variables: casual variables, which are leadership styles of management in a formal organization. They include those variables that are under the control of management. Second, intervening variables, which reflect the internal climate of the organization, such as loyalty and motivation, attitudes, perceptions, performance, goals, etc. Three, end result variables. End result variables are which reflect the objectives of an organization and are the joint product of the casual variables and the intervening variables, such as productivity, service costs, qualities and earnings. According to Likert, the casual variables are independent variables, while the intervening and end result variables are dependent variables. In other words, the styles of leadership, casual variables, influences the followers level of motivation. Intervening variables, which in turn influences the output of the organization, and end result variables. Likert style of leadership is classified into four distinct types: systems, exploitative, authoritative. The leader has no trust or confidence in the subordinate. Communication is entirely formal. Motivation is accompanied by coercion on an occasional reward. Leader is mostly production oriented and has virtually no concern for his followers except as an instrument of production. The leader under system has a strong theory X philosophy and is highly committed to initiating structures as a means of exercising influence. Power and positional authority are the basis of this type of leadership. Control is concentrated in the top management systems. Now, system 2, benevolent authoritative system. The leader has condensing confidence and trust in his subordinates. Communication is mostly formal. Motivation is accomplished by reward and some coercion. The leader has a limited concern for his subordinates, but is still heavily oriented towards production. Power and positional authority are the primary means of enforcing compliance here, although personal authority may be used to supplement legitimacy, reward and coercion. There is some delegation of authority, but control still rides in the top management. Now, system three, third system, is consultative. The leader has the role of confidence in his subordinates, but still wishes to retain control of the decision making power. And communication styles here are formal. Motivation is by reward and coercion with some involvement in decision making on the part of subordinates. The leader in system 3 in this system is less committed to the theory X, and as the situation demands, move towards theory Y, where equal emphasis is laid on consideration and initiating structures. Both positional authority and personal authority are used to gain the acceptance of the subordinates and to enforce their compliance. Control is diffused to the middle and lower levels of management, but the ultimate responsibility still resides in the top management. Now, we come to next system, system 4, it is a participative system. The leader has complete trust and confidence in his subordinates. Communication is both formal and informal and is open in all directions. Motivation is accompanied by a system of rewards developed with the participation of leaders and followers. The leader has a balanced concern for both people and production and relies primarily on the teamwork to progress in both directions. The position of power is de-emphasized and personal authority is predominant here. Recourse to positional authority is infrequent. The responsibility for result still lies with the management, but there is minimal emphasis on control. Participation is used to obtain results. Rennes Likert has divided supervisors into two categories, the employee centered, who care more about employees and their problems and tend to higher productivity than those whom he call job centered. The supervisors are concerned solely with the objectives of organization and their personal work related goals. Supervisors who apply less direct pressure to their employees tend to have a greater productivity level in their departments and work groups. A general supervision is more productive than a very close supervision, and leaders who do not rely on heavy punishment for disciplines are usually more productive. When employees are given some control over the pace of their work in their department, they are likely to be highly productive. On the basis of responses received from the managers, Likert found that quite consistently the high producing units fall under the system 3 and 4 and the low producing units fall under system 1 and 2. The concept of leadership has undergone a sea change from the concept of both a leader to situation, leader to effective leader. Views, assumptions and theories of leadership have changed significantly in recent years. Business and industry have set managers more as leaders to achieve the challenges. The quality of leadership provided by the managers determines the degree of successes of business. Some people are born leaders and they need little training or development. Such managers need training and development to acquire and develop leadership skills. However, born leaders can be more efficient with training. Questions to you. Why the conditions of motivation of employees are important in various styles of leadership? Secondly, what are the major advantages of the participatory system of management? How it involves the employees?